Hello, and welcome to The Organ Show with Ghislaine Rees-Trapp.
And Carl Jackson.
And Andrew Palmley. Welcome to the first ever organ show, live.
With an invited audience in the beautiful church of St Paul's Knightsbridge.
And here to welcome us is the Vicar of St Paul's Knightsbridge, Father Alan Gyle.
As the nation readies itself for the 6th of May, there is an inescapable coronation theme in this year's organ show. We don't yet know much of the detail of the music or the ceremonial in the Abbey, but what we do know is that whatever it says about pomp and splendour and glory, at its heart the coronation service is about a dedicated life, an exemplary life, a life set apart by the nation to speak to the nation of dedication, service, and constancy. Example is so important. I was reflecting this morning why 50 years ago I began to learn to play the organ and to become involved in church music, a step that inevitably led to my being ordained and to the life I lead now. And I realized that although the majesty of the buildings is important and the wonder of the sound of the organ, actually I was converted by the example of a woman who played the organ in my local church. Something of her dedication and her skill spoke to me, and I was inspired, and the rest is history. Actions speak louder than words. Exemplary living is important. It's great that this year's organ show brings together so many of the very best players from around the world, and while the music they make will undoubtedly thrill us, my encouragement to you this year is not just to delight in the music they make, but perhaps to be inspired afresh by their example of dedication to their skill and their art. And let that example, that exemplary living, speak to you, because who knows, for any of us, where such inspiration might lead.
Thank you, Father Alan. The Organ Show is back, and the Royal College of Organists is proud to present a new show for 2023, coming to you on Saturday, the 22nd of April, as we celebrate International Organ Day.
As usual, we will talk about various topics related to organ music and organ playing, not least Bach's famous toccata, BWV 565. But with the huge celebrations in honour of King Charles III just a fortnight away, our main focus tonight is going to be on the upcoming coronation.
And here to play for us is an old friend of the organ show. Ladies and gentlemen, the inimitable Richard Hills with Youth of Britain by Eric Coates. The Youth of Britain in question was the then Princess Elizabeth.
Thank you.
thank you, Richard. Superb, as always.
One of the highlights of the first show 2 years ago was the organ show choir. They are with us now to give the first broadcast performance of the brand new anthem written by former RCO chairman Professor Christopher Wood, God Save the King, accompanied by James Orford and conducted by Andrew Story. Please welcome our singers. Marvellous. We'll be meeting with composer Chris Wood in a short while. Thank you also to the resident organist here at St Paul's Knightsbridge, James Orford.
In 1937, William Walton composed the orchestral march, Crown Imperial. Originally for orchestra and well known in brass band circles, Crown Imperial works brilliantly on the organ. And to prove the point, We're staying with James Orford now as he plays this much-loved piece.
Thank you. of the unsung heroes of the Royal College of Organists is my great friend, Andrew McCrea. Andrew is the Deputy Director and also the Director for Studies. And recently, he's been looking into the music that was performed at Coronations in recent years. We're at the moment not sure what's going to be sung this year, Andrew, but we can make one or two calculated guesses. So, with illustrations by the choir, with Andrew Story, and again with James Orford, please welcome Andrew McCrea. Andrew, I'm going to start with an easy one. What is a coronation?
Well, a coronation is essentially a Eucharist. It's essentially the Holy Communion service. It obviously has some ceremonial insertions, such as an oath, an anointing, and also the crowning, and various other business that needs to be enacted at this service, but it's essentially a Eucharist.
What do we know about the ceremony and about the music traditionally featured?
Well, the ceremony, of course, has taken place in Westminster Abbey since 1066. William the Conqueror was the first to be crowned in the Abbey on Christmas Day 1066. And every monarch who's been crowned, not every monarch has been crowned, of course, but every monarch who's been crowned has been crowned in the Abbey. And King Charles will be the 40th to be crowned.
And do we know anything about the music that's going to feature in the upcoming coronation?
Well, we have had some press releases, of course, and we know that Sir Andrew Lloyd Webber, or Lord Lloyd Webber, I should say, has been commissioned for the coronation anthem, which is a setting of Psalm 98, Sing Unto the Lord a New Song. Ian Farrington is writing an organ piece, which is going to feature lots of themes that are connected with the Commonwealth countries. Judith Weir is writing music for the ceremony. She is Master of the King's Music, of course. And a number of other composers, including Patrick Doyle, who's writing a coronation march for the ceremony.
Fantastic to have so much new music written, but
absolutely,
some pieces seem to have become a feature over the years. Would you like to identify one?
Yes. Well, I don't think there are any guesses really needed there. Zadok the Priest by Handel, written for George II's coronation in 1727. And it's a very interesting story, actually, about the arrangements for the music for that coronation. There seems to have been some disagreements between the clergy and what actually happened ultimately on the musical side. But at any rate, Handel produced four fantastic anthems for that service, including Zadok the Priest. But they're all wonderful pieces. Zadok, though, of course, has stuck. And I think Handel's music, through the commemoration concerts which occurred at the end of the 18th century and beyond, has become such a staple part of the nation's musical life. And Zadok the Priest is that go-to piece, really. And it's there for the anointing. It's the Israelites' acclamation of King Solomon and the recognition of the monarch by the people. What I think is very interesting is how this has become part of the repertory. And of course, that means that the organist has to simulate the orchestra. And I think we've got James lined up to demonstrate how the organist has to become the orchestra to create this marvelous, suspenseful, tension-building, atmospheric opening. So perhaps we should ask James whether he's got some comments and some tips.
So he's on standby. James, what would you like to say about your approach to the introduction to Zadok?
Well, the difficulty with playing a lot of music of this nature is that you are, as the organist, essentially playing a transcription of a transcription. We're often playing piano reductions of the original orchestral material, so I think there has to be quite a bit of artistic license to make it organistic. In the case of a lot of Baroque music and Viennese classical music, my general approach, and of course it's very personal, is the left hand is principally for harmony, the pedal. Often, I will always play the bass part, but often I will use the pedal to provide a lot of rhythmic impetus, and that leaves the right hand to play figurations. Some of the more dexterous violin writing you can leave to the right hand and just leave the left hand playing playing some harmony.
Well, James, thank you very much. Why don't we put you to the test? Perhaps you'd like to give us the introduction to Zadok. Fixed in the cycle of Coronations is Parry's setting of I Was Glad. Now, what's the story there?
Well, I Was Glad, setting of Psalm 122, of course, is there for the entrance of the monarch at the beginning of the service. And because the setting by Sir Hubert Parry of 1902 has become so fixed in our minds, we forget, of course, that it was set by other composers. Purcell, or possibly Blow, I think the jury is out on exactly who wrote the setting for James II's coronation. But there are settings by Boyce and Atwood. But it's Parry's setting of 1902, with some revisions in 1911, which has really been fixed in the national musical psyche. And it's very interesting to compare the openings of the 1902 version and the 1911 version, because they are different. What we are so familiar with didn't come along until 1911. So I think we've got our musicians lined up to give us the opening as people heard it in 1902. As I understand it, they heard it twice because the cue went up too early that the king had arrived, and that was not the case, so they had to go round again. But the 1902 version, it's a shorter introduction, but it's nonetheless a very interesting introduction. It's marked larghetto rather than maestoso or largamente. There are, you know, slight differences to the mood of the opening.
Well, I don't think I've ever heard the 1902 version, so I wonder, Andrew, if you could give us the opening of 1902 and then skip to 1911.
Well, we know that whatever we do here at the coronation, it's going to be stirring, and we know that, as ever, the organ will be front and centre when it comes to a day of national celebration. Could I ask you, please, to join me in thanking Andrew McCrea for his fascinating insights?
Well, who knew that I was glad originally had a different introduction? That was fascinating.
Now, leading us from the coronation of Edward VII in 1902 to that of George V in 1911 is our next story. Back in the early 20th century, the American department store pioneer John Wanamaker was commonly regarded as the undisputed king of retail business. Wanamaker's enormous seven-story department store in Philadelphia was erected in 1910, and it also included a gargantuan organ, then the largest organ in the world, originally built for the St. Louis World's Fair of 1904. The organ's installation in Philadelphia took about 2 years, and the date for the inauguration of the instrument was chosen to coincide with the coronation of King George V at Westminster Abbey in June 1911.
Well, while Wanamaker's son Rodman was attending the inauguration of the organ, John Wanamaker was present at the coronation in London. He even presented the City of London with a painting commemorating a luncheon in the presence of the newly crowned King George and Queen Mary. The Wanamaker store at the same time had replicas of the crown jewels and even of the coronation chair on display. In the spirit of the amazing connection between the Wanamaker store and the British monarchy, a special organ recital will be performed in the Wanamaker store on the day of King Charles's coronation. So let's now go to Philadelphia and hear from Peter Richard Conte, the resident organist at the Wanamaker organ, and get a sneak preview of that performance.
Hello, my name is Peter Richard Conte. Welcome to the Wanamaker Grand Court at Macy's for all our friends in the Royal College of Organists. It's great to be with you here in the Grand Court. I'm sitting at what is the world's largest fully functioning musical instrument, the Wanamaker Grand Court organ. Some 469 ranks, almost 29,000 pipes. It speaks into a court that is 146 feet tall and nearly as long. It's of immense proportions, and the organ fills this space quite beautifully. This organ is in the symphonic style, the American symphonic style, and it is the king of that symphonic school, if you will. Much like a symphony orchestra, this organ contains almost one-third of its voices are string stops, like you'd find on an orchestral stage. There's 118 ranks, in fact, of string tone in one chamber. The string division has 118 ranks of just string tone. So it is the size and scope of three symphony orchestras, and it really does envelop the sound of an orchestra, which makes transcription playing especially very much enjoyable and very convincing, in fact. What you just heard is a piece by William Matthias, which some of you may remember. This was a piece that was commissioned for the dedication of the Royal College of Organists organ in 1967, and I performed it here on this instrument for you. Another very important occasion, obviously, is the coronation of King Charles coming up later this year. We're going to be performing a recital on the Wanamaker organ on that very same day, much like was done in 1911 for the coronation of King George V. And on that same day was the inauguration of this organ, the first time it played in this building. This organ originally existed as the 1904 World's Fair organ, and then John Wanamaker hauled it here in 13 freight cars and set it up and then expanded it. But it first played in this building in 1911 on the exact day that King George was crowned. It's great to be with you all here in the Grand Court. I send you fond greetings from this side of the pond. I'm going to finish up today with Elgar's Pomp and Circumstance March No. 4, transcribed by Brian Hesford. All the best from Philadelphia.
What an organ! You may be interested to learn that Peter Richard Conte has recorded an entire selection of coronation-related music exclusively for the Royal College of Organists. It will be made available from Coronation Day on our RCO YouTube channel as part of the Organ Show Extra playlist.
And now for something completely different. A man not unfamiliar with large organs is Michael Broadway, formerly the tuner of the organs of St. Paul's Cathedral and the Royal Albert Hall.
Michael is also one of the country's foremost exponents of the pianola. What, I hear you exclaim, but that's a machine, you must be thinking. Well, you would be partly right and partly wrong. In the right hands, the pianola can be beautifully expressive. Also, of course, it is being played by hands and feet, almost like an organ. Performing Moszkowski's arrangement of Bizet's Chanson Bohème from Carmen, here to demonstrate the true art of pianola performance, please welcome Michael Broadway.
Thank you.
By surprise.
And now we have another surprise, not one new coronation anthem, but two. What's more, both composers are with us. Here to chat with Andrew McCrea about composing for a king, please welcome Joanna Forbes L'Estrange and Professor Christopher Wood.
We're indeed very fortunate in having in the organ show not one coronation-related anthem, but two. And we're doubly blessed in that we have both of the composers of these works with us today. We've already heard Professor Christopher Wood's anthem, and we shall soon be hearing Joanna Forbes L'Estrange's anthem. It's a great delight to see you here today. And Joanna, you're a singer, you're a composer, you're a choral director. You were involved, of course, with the Swingle Singers for many years as musical director and one of the one of the crew. I'd like to ask you about the backstory for your piece, which we're going to hear soon. And
yes.
Then I'm going to move to Christopher. But Joanna, could you tell us about your backstory to this piece?
Yes, absolutely. Well, the RSCM, the Royal School of Church Music, who've been publishing my choral music for a number of years now, were very keen that the coronation shouldn't just be at Westminster Abbey with the Westminster Abbey choir and all of that, but actually the choirs all over the UK and hopefully all over the Commonwealth would want to mark the coronation musically where they are. And so they commissioned me to write a piece which choirs all over the country would sing. And the brief was very much that it should be mainly a tune, like a big hymn was the words that they used. There are harmony parts as well, but there's also a unison version. But the idea is that anybody, whether it was a young choir or an older choir or a well-established choir, amateur choir, professional choir, that anybody would be able to sing it. Other than that, I was given pretty much free rein. I chose a couple of psalms which I felt reflected Charles, King Charles, as a person. I know that he has a love of music. We're both cellists, and I know that he loves the countryside and walking, and so I was really pleased with these particular psalm texts, and I felt that they very much reflected him.
Thank you, Joanna. We'll talk a little bit more about the composition in a moment, but Christopher, congratulations on your piece. We've enjoyed hearing it very much today. Now, you have a medical background. You were a surgeon in medicine for many years, but you're also a composer, and you've been very active in recent times with a requiem and a missa brevis, and very movingly you wrote something to commemorate the Apafan disaster some years ago. Perhaps you could just tell us about your journey into music, and then tell us a bit more about your backstory to this particular piece.
Well, I was a surgeon for many years working in the NHS. I'm mainly a cancer surgeon, but grew up in a musical family. My mother was in the chorus of the Welsh National Opera, so we sang more than we spoke, really, I think, at home, if I remember rightly. And my earliest memories are singing, and mum teaching me how to sing. And singing with choirs, I think what it taught me was what a good tune sounds like, and more particularly, what a good bass line sounds like. And that was really the background to starting composition, which was something I started just as a hobby, just for my own pleasure. And it was, strangely enough, it was to do with the Queen Mother's death. When the Queen Mother died, I saw all those people, thousands of people, queuing for hours to pay their respect. And I thought, if they were a choir, what would they sing that would capture their emotions of that day? And so I thought I'd sit down and write a requiem, which I did, and that was the start. This piece for the coronation, I wanted to create words and music that would capture the moment and the momentous occasion that this coronation is. Because when you think about it, perhaps the majority of the people in this country have never witnessed a coronation. This will be their first. So I wanted two things. Firstly, to try and capture the solemnity, which you've already mentioned, and the significance and the importance of this coronation and this momentous event. But secondly, I just simply wanted to express my hopes and my prayers for the king's reign.
And could you tell us about the words? Because you have written the words yourself, haven't you? And you didn't go to the Psalms, and you didn't go to biblical texts, as Joanna did, but you decided that you were going to pen something yourself.
It's strange. I thought, how am I best going to express this? And God Save the King seemed to be a good way to start. Now, admittedly, the anthem starts that way, and I'll come to that, if you like, on how I wanted to differentiate. But then I wanted to say, well, let's see what's happening here. Let heaven and earth proclaim the new and glorious name that joins the noble ranks of all those who've worn the stately crown. Because that's what's happening. You mentioned the lineage of the kings and queens. This is a long historic tradition. And here we are, anointing a new king. And I wanted to express that in words and music.
Those continuities are really interesting, aren't they? Joanna, I wonder whether you could tell us a little bit about your musical influences and whether the weight of so much past coronation music has weighed heavily upon you, or has it been a great stimulus?
Well, I've been immersed in choral music my whole life. I was a chorister from when I was seven in my local parish church choir. And then I went on to read music at Oxford University, and I was singing with a wonderful choir, Schola Cantorum of Oxford. We sang so many different kinds of music, really. And then after that, sang with the Swingle Singers, as you mentioned. Lots of contemporary music, a lot of jazz, and then I've sung with Tenebrae for 20 years. So I think my main influences really are all of the music that I have sung as a professional singer. I think I feel that maybe even more strongly than influences of past composers. Like you were saying, I love a really great tune, and I love to analyse what makes a really great tune and why there are certain hymns that people love to sing. And because, as I said earlier, my main brief for this particular piece was the tune, I had a lot of fun sitting at the piano and playing my favourite hymn tunes and working out that a lot of them have these big octave leaps in them, or maybe a leap of a seventh, that they grow. And so, you know, in a sense, one tends to think of music as being easier if it's moving in stepwise motion. But actually, it's these large leaps and also the descents, large descents. For example, dear Lord and Father of mankind, forgive our foolish ways. La-da-da-da-da-da. And then growing up again. And so, yes, I think in preparation for this piece, it was mainly thinking about my experiences as a singer and when what makes a great hymn tune.
Yes, so your own sense of vocality.
Yes, definitely. And when I'm writing music, that's what I'm thinking. I'm imagining singing it, and I'm imagining directing it, and I'm imagining the choir singing it, and I'm coming at it from quite a sort of practical perspective, and also from my own faith, the fact that I've been a churchgoer all my life, and my father's an organist, and my earliest memories of perched on the stool organ bench next to him, being given the occasional stop to pull out or page to turn. So yes, all of those things I think very much informed the piece.
And tell us about the multiple versions that are available at this piece.
Yes.
We go to the RSCM website.
Yes.
And download various versions.
Yes.
Can you take us through the options?
Absolutely. So in its simplest form, the piece is a unison line and a piano accompaniment. And so a lot of the choirs, especially youth choirs, I conducted a youth choir at Guildhall last week, 90 8 to 14 year olds, and we did the unison version, and that's great for them because it's just a big old tune, you know, it's quick to learn, and it's in different sections, so some choirs have just learnt maybe the opening section, sort of fanfare, some choirs have learnt the central section, which is the mountain shall bring peace, the softer section, and some choirs have learnt the hymn bit, which is the end bit that you'll hear later. So that's its simplest form. And then there's an SATB plus organ version. And then, well, actually what they've done on the RSCM website is very clever, but they've got a version which has all, they've got a downloadable pack that has all of the versions in. It's very reasonably priced, I should say. If they were here, then I'm sure they'd want me to say that. But you can make as many copies for your choir as you want. So that's quite a sort of clever way of doing it. But essentially, even if you had, there are some choirs now that have sopranos, altos, and then an amalgamated lower line, it would work perfectly fine just to sing one of the tenor and bass lines that I've written, because all of the harmonies are in the accompaniment. So accessible is the word.
It strikes me that it resonates very much with Rayford Williams.
Yes.
And his work to encourage community music making.
Yes.
And of course, he very famously set the Old Hundredth.
Exactly.
The 53 Coronation.
Exactly.
And which is, of course, an embedded part of our national repertoire.
It really is. And I think, you know, composers like Vaughan Williams, you know, they really believed in community music making,
yes,
as do I. And I think it's funny, my sons were choristers in St. John's, Cambridge. In fact, they had Andrew Nethsinger as their director. And I remember thinking, gosh, you know, I wish I'd had that experience of singing in a big, famous choir in a cathedral. But actually now, I really do feel that my calling is writing for the humble parish church choir that I started out in. I love to write for choirs like that, and although it's lovely when, you know, Tenebrae and these other wonderful choirs record my music, there's something for me about when I receive a message through my website saying, I sing in this little choir and we just love your music. I feel that's my calling.
That's wonderful. Thank you, Joanna. And Chris, tell us about how we can get hold of
Well, Joanna makes,
a very important point. This music has to be accessible. What we've heard today is the SATB version with wonderful organ playing and at its pinnacle. But we want this to be sung in parish churches. We want this to be sung where there aren't any tenors. And so we've also likewise prepared various versions of it and teaching lines. So if the altos want to learn their line, they can pick it up from the website. And it's important.
Absolutely. Mm. Well, thank you very much for these wonderful insights. And as I said at the beginning of the interview, that it's so wonderful to have two coronation-related pieces and to have the composers with us today to talk about them. So thank you very much, Joanna and Christopher. And now, let's hear a performance of the Mountains Shall Bring Peace by Joanna Forbes L'Estrange with the Organ Show Choir, conducted by Andrew Story, accompanied by James Orford, and featuring our wonderful audience.
Thank you.
Besides working closely with the Royal School of Church Music, the Royal College of Organists has a wide range of creative partnerships across the world. And now here to help us celebrate International Organ Day 2023 is our great friend, the Executive Director of the American Guild of Organists, James Thomashower.
Greetings, I'm James Thomashower, Executive Director of the American Guild of Organists. And on behalf of the AGO National Council and our headquarters staff, I bring greetings to you, the RCO, and to your Chief Executive, Andrew Parmley, my very good friend, on the occasion of the 2023 RCO Organ Show. I'm here at Riverside Church, right across the street from AGO headquarters. Riverside Church is a magnificent church on the Upper West Side of Manhattan, which has been the home to many fabulous organists who have played this incredible Aeolian Skinner organ that is behind me with the console off to my right. You can't see the pipes because they're behind a screen, but trust me, there are lots of them. In fact, this is the second largest pipe organ in all of New York City. Martin Luther King also gave a very famous sermon here in 1967 when he was speaking against the war in Vietnam. Coming up this summer are the regional conventions of the American Guild of Organists, at which 100 to maybe 200 people will be in attendance at each one. We have six different sites. I invite you to come to a regional convention here in the United States. Pick one of your choice. They're all published every single month in TAO. Next summer, 2024, we will have our national convention in San Francisco. And I invite you to come to San Francisco, follow in the footsteps of Andrew McCrea and Morwenna Campbell-Smith of the RCO, who came and joined us in Seattle in 2022. They had a wonderful time. Don't take my word for it. Ask them. We would love to be able to greet you in San Francisco at our 2024 national convention, June 30 to July 4. July 4, that's Independence Day. It's a very festive day for us. Speaking of festive days, you've got a big one coming up with the coronation of King Charles III. I congratulate the United Kingdom on the occasion of this important day, and we wish we could be with you in person. The best we can do is watch it on TV, and I assure you we will be watching. Thank you once again for the opportunity to be with you on the 2023 RCO Organ Show, and I'm going to turn it back to the good engineers in RCO headquarters. Thank you.
The Royal College of Organists is also proud to collaborate with Choir and Organ, a leading independent magazine for professionals and amateurs in the choral and organ worlds. The magazine aims to inspire its readers through giving a platform to conductors, organists, composers, and choirs of every kind, and by showcasing the imaginative craft of pipe organ building across the centuries, appraising new organs, and addressing novel ethics in restoring historic instruments. Founder-editor Basil Ramsey set out his stall in the very first edition 30 years ago, writing that the magazine would examine issues of the moment, commission articles from experts, and review newly published material of relevance. Since the magazine launched in 1993, there has been a digital revolution. So now, in addition to a print version, there is also a full digital edition, as well as an accompanying e-newsletter. The complete 30-year archive of Choir and Organ is available online, together with latest news, features, reviews, and new music scores. Thanks to Choir and Organ's editor Maggie Hamilton, RCO members can save 20% on subscriptions using the code RCO23.
Many of you will have seen old pianos left in public places, particularly in railway stations. But how many of you have seen a pipe organ in a public place? Martin Renshaw had the marvellous idea of placing a pipe organ in London Bridge Station. The RCO president, David Hill, went along to see what it is all about. The music is played by this year's winner of the RCO Olympus Prize, the very talented Carolyn Craig, FRCO.
Martin, it's lovely to be here at London Bridge Station with your organ, which you put here, and it's fantastic. I've had such a privilege playing it recently. Tell us about it.
Well, we don't know its past history before about 2000, but when I saw it, I was tipped off about it, and I thought, this germ of an idea I already had of putting an organ in a station, having seen the pianos in St. Pancras, began to take form, because it seemed to be exactly the right sort of organ to put in this station. Small, pretty, robust, but with all the bits of an organ. So there's everything to learn from it. And stored it in my garage, or at least my partner's garage in Hampstead for a year, while we got the various permissions to bring it here.
Fantastic. And clearly it's attracting a huge amount of interest, isn't it?
Of course, astounding, actually. It's beyond my wildest expectations, in fact. It seems to be being played 10, 12 hours a day by everybody you can imagine.
Well, one final question would be, I mean, with it being used so much, Martin, how much are you having to kind of come in and maintain it?
Well, quite a bit. But actually, in the first place, quite a lot. But more recently, not very often. We did have a little go at it the other day, because things do get broken. People stand on the pedals, inevitably. But, you know, there's a wooden manual action. That was working fine. The blower seems to go all the time without any trouble, which is quite amazing.
So,
really,
from what you told me, it's a really sturdy organ from
luckily.
North London, from a United Reformed Church, is that
That's
it?
Right, yes.
That was became redundant, so obviously great stock and obviously doing a marvellous job.
Well, and I'm sure we can find other organs like it. In fact, we have found other organs like it.
Good. Well, Martin, thank you so much for telling us about this amazing project. Thank you. Welcome to London Bridge and the organ here. It's great to be here. Tell us, what is the fascination between trains and organs?
I don't really... I mean, it's prevalent, isn't it? I mean, I'm sure we can share stories of people we know who are interested in both. For me, I reckon it's something to do with just a steam locomotive, for example.
Yeah.
It's this multi-sensory object. It sort of moves the earth around it. You feel heat radiating off it and all the rest of it, in the same way that an organ sort of moves the space that it sits in. They're such rhythmical things, steam locomotives, and actually trains generally, you know, they clatter over the joints of the point work and so on and so forth. So I think it's a sonic thing, first and foremost, and then a mechanical thing.
I totally agree. And do you think that the engineering aspect, I mean, if you think about it, going back probably to the organ's development, it was the most complicated piece of any kind of machinery of its time. And whether that's that correlation between that engineering and then, of course, the great, you know, the great moment when the railways began and the sound of steam, the whole kind of concept of engineering, which is such a kind of fascinating aspect of it. It seems to kind of come together, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. And I would say, you know, but both have had their moments in the sun as the sort of most advanced object that man has made, surely. I mean, if you think about a vast North German or Dutch organ of the 17th or 18th century, I mean, there's nothing more complicated than that, surely. I mean, you know, sailing ships with all their ropes, perhaps, but as a piece of mechanical ingenuity, nothing to beat it, I would have thought. And then you get into the 19th century and it's going to be steam locomotives and mill engines and all that sort of stuff, that it's at the absolute cutting edge.
And organ composers who have occasionally kind of put into their music some references to trains sometimes, and you know, that kind of thing, and you know,
You know, that kind of aping the sound of trains and so on. And then you occasionally get composers doing that. I mean, and you've got some references to that, haven't you?
Well, I mean, the one that really springs to mind is Jean Alain's piece Litanies, which grew out of another piece called Phantasmagorie. But there's a rhythmic sort of device in there, which allegedly is inspired by a railway trip. It goes like this.
There you go.
You know what? It seems appropriate to sit in a railway station and play that, doesn't it?
Well, you know what? I've heard that piece 100 times and it never occurred to me. Well, does occur to me now I hear it.
Yeah, it's funny. It's definitely there,
not before.
It?
Absolutely, definitely there. Tom, it's great to chat about this. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, Carolyn. It's lovely to see you here and in London Bridge Station with this organ.
Thank you.
Carolyn is, of course, winner of big prizes in the FRCO, Olympus and Reed. Many congratulations.
Thank you so much.
And, of course, you've just been playing this organ. What have we just been hearing? Tell us about it.
I just played a bit of the Bach Fantasia in G minor, BWV 542. It's a wonderfully dissonant work, harmonically ahead of its time, extremely rhetorical, and it's just a fantastic treat to play on this instrument.
Did you know about this instrument, by the way, before you had to play it?
I did, yeah. I think the RCO has done a great job of publicizing it. So I've seen various newspaper clips, and I think Anna Lapwood and a load of other people have been here, and actually just on Facebook, maybe two nights ago, I saw someone playing here who's not involved with the RCO, which is exactly what we're looking for.
Indeed, indeed. And of course, you're presently working in Westminster Cathedral. How are you finding that?
I'm absolutely loving it. It's really good fun. Yeah.
What kind of differences are you finding, say, from working in churches in America? What do you feel is different about this?
Ooh. Well, I don't know if it's just a thing. It's not just different from churches in America. It's different from most churches, period. So that most of the choral music is polyphonic and Gregorian chant, that there is mass every day. I think it has choral mass every day. It's the only place in the UK that I think can
That's
say
right.
That.
And probably in the Catholic world, it is unique, isn't it?
Yes, very much so.
And you finding the sort of change of repertoire has been really, you know, different for you and kind of introducing whole new things?
The main thing, I think, is Gregorian chant informs how we sing everything. So it's all based on that sense of line.
Yeah.
And that permeates all of our music making. And Simon's really big on that.
Of course. And how do you find that with the boys? When I was there for a few years, I found that they became the really quickest sight readers because they understood four note notation.
Oh, yeah.
And
because the things that they... polyphony is not predictable as well.
So
I think they become really good readers through the rep that they do.
Great. Well, it's great to talk to you, Carolyn, and thank you so much.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure.
That's a really interesting question, Ghislaine. I think some of it's to do with the piece itself, that it's so memorable. I mean, if you look at the Toccata, it's strong on rhetoric. It doesn't hold back in its communication, perhaps a bit less so strong motivically in the building blocks. The fugue, there's lots of repetition, there's lots of sequence. And I think, you know, if you're not a member, if you like, of the concert-going public, I think it's an attractive piece that you can access. And I think that's why it has such wide appeal. Now, the question as to why it became popular is more complex, partially due to Mendelssohn. Mendelssohn included it in his organ concerts in Leipzig and championed it, and it became well known through that. Ultimately, the big thing I think that brought it to a wide audience was Walt Disney Fantasia, where everyone knows the famous organ excerpt from Moszkowski orchestration. And I think that single thing is probably what brought it to such notoriety. I think it's a double-edged sword, actually, because on the one hand, you say organ, Bach's Staccato and Fugue in D minor. It also has images of the gothic, of the horror, of things dark. It's quite an intensely dark piece, I think, pretty, fairly unremittingly so. And I think in these days when we're finding new friends for the organ, perhaps it's a shame that that has become, if you like, the post song for it. But, you know, that's where we're at. And it's a very arresting piece.
Absolutely. And am I right in thinking a pianola arrangement of the piece was really popular at one time?
That's right, yeah. So I gather, I think, Michael Broadway, Michael's been here today with his pianola, actually has a roll of this, so we can actually hear what it sounded like back in the earlier 20th century. Yeah, a very different approach to Bach, but fascinating nonetheless, yeah. Complicated. I'll give the simple version so as not to bore everybody. The very first manuscript of the piece is relatively late. At one time we thought that it might even date from after Bach's death, this first version, as recorded by a student of a student of Bach, although some recent research suggests it was probably written about 20 years or so before Bach's death. But there's quite a lot of thought that if Bach wrote it, and that's a big if, that Bach might well have written it in his younger years. So how come this version that survives was written so late? There are various complications here. I won't go into them now, but on the film we explore this in quite some depth. It sounds terribly dry, and I'm not one, I have to admit, to be tracing the provenance of manuscripts, but I got really, really caught up in the story. It's a fascinating story about what we know about how this piece emerged from Bach, or was it somebody else, and then became one of the best-known pieces in the world.
And so for the big question...
I'm waiting for it. I think I know what it says. Yeah. You know, for the film, we had to come to a conclusion because people like films with strong conclusions. It's the Hollywood ending, isn't it? And we did come to a conclusion. If I was asked in all honesty, I would say from what I see of the evidence, there's a good chance that it was by Bach, but there are so many question marks, and I suspect, at least for my lifetime, it will remain an enigma. Ultimately, for me, as a musician, I'm less excited about the question of whether it definitely was by Bach or not than just enjoying performing it, and I think that's why, as a legacy, it will live on for generations and generations to come.
Thank you, Ghislaine and Dan. And while Dan makes his way over to the console of the Paul Manuel Willis here in St. Paul's, let's once again cross the pond. Here is the brilliant Canadian organist David Enler, playing the 1916 Cassavant organ at the Church of the Resurrection on Manhattan's Upper East Side. Let's hear a fugal improvisation combining God Save the King and O Canada.
Thank you.
ingenuity there.
And now, let's hear Daniel Malt playing Johann Sebastian Bach's Toccata and Fugue in D minor.
And he will be improvising. And what else could it be on but a coronation march in honour of King Charles III?
Thank you.
Breathtaking. Now, who says organists don't know how to have fun? For our grand finale, we have Michael Broadway on his push-up pianola, we have Ghislaine Rees-Trapp on the keyed glockenspiel, and we have the audience on, well, you'll just have to wait and see. Andrew Storey will do his best to coordinate this extraordinary group as it performs the concluding section of Tchaikovsky's 1812 overture.
Indeed, and it is always such a pleasure to visit St. Paul's Knightsbridge. Thank you very much for your hospitality, Father Alan and team.
And to everybody here at St. Paul's, as well as to you watching via YouTube, thank you for being with us. We hope you've enjoyed this year's organ show live.
And please make a note in your diaries to join us next year on Saturday, the 20th of April, 2024, for the really big organ show, when we shall once again say, tune in and be inspired.